Today, I will share with you about co-creation process that we have been working together to develop it together. So actually this year of 2021 is maybe we can call it like a 10-year anniversary of CAN Network. So I wish this presentation can be part of the celebration of our hard work. And yeah, I can say at the beginning that, you know, what I share with you today is I can say it's our work. It's a part of network. Without the network, without the hard work that everyone be part of, it will, you know, never happen what we try to do. So I wish what I sharing today can remind you to your own journey as well. And for the new people that just start this kind of work, we also welcome you to the network, welcome you to searching for the meaningful work and living. So I put the name like this, co-create meaningful living. I think I quite wondering about our work. What is the development that people keep talking about? What is the, you know, what is the participatory? What is the real service that we can give to ourselves and others? So I try to put everything together and share with you today. So I will start with the word from Jay Krishnamurti. He's a remarkable man. He said, "The mind must free itself from the known to enter the unknown." So when I look back to our work of my life from the last 20 years that I have been working with communities and with nature, I realize that most of the time, you know, we try to explore the unknown. We try to go out of what we know. And in that way, we get a new knowledge about ourselves and about the world. Of course, it's quite scary for many of us at the beginning, you know, to go out of the comfort zone. But I think this word from Krishnamurti and other remarkable men or our senior, you know, to enter the unknown is maybe, it's quite important, you know, we can step into the new territory, new journey, new unknown. You don't have to know everything before you work. That's a machine approach. We never know what will happen in our work because it's a part of life, of living system. So, you know, whenever you realize yourself that you step into the unknown, I think you should thank to yourself and be conscious, be present that you will be in the very important step for your own and for the others. And I always curious, you know, how the world, how the nature work, because it's quite amazing, isn't it? How our body work, how the nature work, because that give us a lot of the quality of co-creation. This is the aerial photograph of Sundarban area in Bangladesh, maybe one of the largest mangrove area in the world. And you can see, if you keep observe and ask yourself and learn from the nature, which is you yourself also be part of nature, the air that you breathe, the water that you drink, you use the food from the earth, everything, you are part of the earth, and you can you know, meditate or contemplate from this aerial photograph and ask how the nature works, how it co-create itself. It's quite amazing, and sometimes we don't get a clear answer, but we, you know, we can get some quality or some sense of how the living system work. You know, it's always changing, and it has some scientists said the law of nature is to flow, you know, to flow and to connect to each other or interconnected. You know, every particle, every part of the world try to change itself. Or the form in the nature try to allow the flow of the subtle flow to meet each other, to support each other. That's the deepest law of nature. And this gives us a lot of new understanding of the new side, the holistic side. No? For example, from the book of Margaret J. Whitley, she talked about the new definition of life from the biologists. From the 21st century, whatever you call living thing, it means it have a capacity to create itself. So that is the basic force within every living system. So that means, you know, we are human being and we have a lot of cell, you know, very complicated system as a living being. You can see this is a photo of a neuron cell, no? The nerve cell in our brain. It's very complex. And if you want to find some model or some system that very complex but co-creative, this is one of the very important and very amazing system. It's in our body and our brain, you know. And again, from the book of Margaret J. Whitley, I quite admire and appreciate for her work. It's inspired me and our camp coordinator a lot of her work, her book. She said we need process to help us to revive and connection, to discover and share interest, to listen to one another's story and dream. We need process that take advantage of our nature, natural ability to network, to communicate when something is meaningful. So it can give us a clue that every cell, every single living unit, they're searching for the way that they want to create itself and they want to connect with other, you know, to form a living system where they can grow, where they can thrive together. That is the deepest quality of the living system. Why I keep talking about this, because if you observe in your cell, in your organization, or in your country, in your system, in your community, we adopt the machine system where it's destroyed the human capacity of to co-create, to love, to have compassion, you know, to have empathy. That is not our true nature. It's just a very superficial, but it's very strong that we develop the machine culture. So we're searching for the way we can live together, work together. And you can do that if you create a process to connect each other and allow everyone to search for the meaning. And we organize ourselves around the meaning that we find. You can see from the diagram, this is the left one is the machine system that, you know, emerged from the own scientists, maybe not more than 300 years. But the right one is come from the living, the diagram came from the living system. It don't have a center, it's more like the network and it have a free flow of connecting, you know, everyone connect to each other to a different linkage. We can call this a non-resilient system. And many scientists, many philosophers, many urbanists, they got a lot of inspiration from this kind of new understanding about the living system. And they try to bring back to use in the design approach, the design process, or in the design of internet, business, whatever, because this is the new quality that we can bring back to create a living system where we can thrive, where we can be more empathy and compassionate and be more creative. How can we adopt this new understanding to our work? You know, I talking a lot about mapping last time, and mapping is the process where you can connect people to the reality of their environment, of their culture, of their physical thing. And it's allow people to meet each other, have dialogue to each other. And in this way, you know, everyone have their own expertise to share to each other. They don't have a clear hierarchy like a leader and the follower, you know. In the process like this, you always move people to the unknown, because from the last 300 years, you know, we stay and we adapt the machine cultures. We need leader to tell us what to do. We need architects, expert, you know, to tell the people what to do. That's our own system. It will not work anymore. Or if it work, it will not life. It will not joy. It will not creative anymore. We need a new kind of process that, you know, we can have a deep connection between each other and can create collective creativities. This is our office is like this, you know. Our office of community architect is within the communities, and we don't need a, you know, we can work everywhere where the people living and where they want to searching for. This also the mapping in process in Philippines. And the living process, the process that you trust the people, trust yourself, trust in the human capacity, you know, it can surprising you. For example, this is a design process that I did maybe 15 years ago with the landless people in the Muslim region in the southern part of Thailand. The women who naturally by the culture of you know Muslim people in the southern part of Thailand, the women who are the one who respond for the take care of the children, work within the house, they're not allowed to talk much in the public. So when I realized that when we mix men and women together in one group, the women always silent. But actually they have a lot of knowledge about how to design a better communities, how to design a better house, because they are the one who spend most of the time in the community, who manage the money, who take care of the kid, and who take care of the neighbor. So that's a real knowledge that the people have, and sometimes architects too confident to know how to design their community. Actually, we can decide a process in which people can design their own communities, and we can add on to some technical or some idea. So in this process, the women group, they share about a new resettlement site that they want like a small cluster for their own neighborhood, for their own kid to play. If we have only one big cluster, the kid can come to play here, but the mother who cook inside cannot see their kid, so they worry. So it very delicate thought, you know, on this kind of arrange the public space. And as an architect, we can develop the idea, and you know, of the people. We have a lot of knowledge about how to build things, but we need the idea from the people. We need the dialogue to happen in the communities. We need the vision. We need a collective vision from the people, and then we can develop a pilot housing, you know, to show how the low-cost housing based on their culture, based on their material, this is just like $1,000 per one house. It's like a small cluster. And again, this is our office. The area where the people will relocate is it's like a sand dune forest. It's very beautiful. So we organize a workshop, the design workshop in the site. So the people can, you know, survey, the people can appreciate the site, the people can explore. Also the kid can explore what they like about it, what they worry about it. So we can bring this quality into the design, you know. It's very important for architect and planner to always work in the flow of people, you know. The people, they can think better when they're in the real environment, when their body is moved, the same as us. But maybe we used to sitting and, you know, work in the office, analyze it alone. That's the old world. It will not empower you and people anymore, that way of thinking. So we need to step out of the know, and, you know, to work like this, it's a bit chaotic at the beginning. Maybe people cannot concentrate much, or sometimes the rare bird came and they sing and people surprised. So it's a lot of phenomena that happen that will be a part of this side process that we have to embrace, and, you know, let work this way, and you will surprise yourself, because every time something surprise you, you need to, you know, to be conscious and open for that new thought to emerge. And this the same size, same process. We always have a process. When you work with like a big communities, it's difficult for people to feel comfortable to talk about their idea. So it's very simple to allow people to group in the very small group, you know, and the people can choose the group by themselves based on their relationship, based on their job, based on their existing area, whatever. So it's important for us and the people to choose to go to the group, to the process by itself, because that the way we start to bring the consciousness to the workshop, and they can start to discern, develop a discernment, you know, what is good, what is bad, what is good for them, what is good for the community. So we need to avoid the own system of machine, the order, the, you know, the rigid framework that doesn't allow the living system or co-creation process to flow naturally. Many times we organize a big workshop in one room. You can divide the small group according to the issue or to the size of the work, but it's important for the whole workshop should organize in one big room where you can create a atmosphere of working together, and the people can get inspired by a different way of working, no matter group they are, but they can always send the different way of work, the atmosphere. Maybe some group is very serious, some group start to laugh, some group are in the deep thought. So this kind of different quality will, you know, will support each other. And of course, we need to engage with the government and the own system. So we need some formal way to dealing with the government or the other sector. Yeah, but if you organize the workshop in the living process, so when you come to the formal process, I think it will have a different quality, because the people know what they want to talk about, what is the vision that they want to go. And this is the process that I worked for a resettlement project 15 years ago. We encourage people to make their own dream house in the same scale of 1 to 100, and they try to put together as a new settlement. You know, and it have a lot of dialogue from this process. they can learn from each other about the different design, different way of saving money, and they start thinking about the rule or regulation, you know, how wide of the footpath, how wide of the road, where they should put the, you know, electricity ports, where they should put the toilet, you know, to avoid not to disturb the neighbor, something like that. So, you know, when you bring a process into a dialogue and make it visual, make it tangible, touchable, so it's very powerful. And the people will understand by this kind of action, you know. We not separate learning, action, discussion, analysis. We do it together and we always open. And when they did it by themselves, they have a deep understanding about how to decide their own house. They have a deep understanding about how the new life will reorganize, how much saving they need to have per day. And they can, you know, when we work together, we share our dream, we share our knowledge. So other people, other community people, these are the group of different community who live in the same site. So they start to know each other through this process of like a 3 month of design the new settlement together. And you can see some kid is sleeping here. You know, the women can bring their kid to participate. It's very lively because it's part of their life. No one take care of their kids. So they bring a kid to the workshop. And the kid also share the idea how the new community they want, where is the playground they want, something like that. And this is something I learned from my mistake. Sometimes the mistake is the solution. Normally I will prepare the material for people to make a model. And one day I forgot to bring those material. And you know, it's very funny. So I said, sorry, today I forgot to bring a cardboard and, you know, some glue, you know, for you to make a model, but you learn how to make a drawing and make a model. So it's a homework for you today to, you know, to make a model, and we will come back and share about that model how. And you know, every family start to find a way how to make their own model in the scale of 100 that we working together. So this is like a quite surprising me. They can use a very own box of chicken soup, and she can use their own straw, no? And she can tell a lot of detail, like she will use her own door and window here because they lend the land and they can, you know, remove some old material to build a new house. So in this way, you know, from my mistake that I forgot the material, is become a solution for them. So after that, I never prepare any material for people to make a model. The people have to find a way to demonstrate and use whatever material we just train people how to make it in the same scale so they can, you know, compare, they can share the idea for each other. And this is the model how in Myanmar, in Yangon, the community network and the NGO over there, they encourage the community builder to have a competition for the cheapest smart house. So you can see, if you ask about how to create the process where the people can participate and can be more creative. So in that way, it's open you to think about different things, you know, different actor. So you don't need to act according to what you know, only you need to, you know, open it and see how things happen. And in the workshop in Myanmar at the beginning, when I worked there in 2010, I just walked to the toilet. This is the, like the workshop room. And I look at the floor and I realize that the tile is like a one by 1 feet. So it's like a grid paper that we give to the people to design the house. So I have an idea to, you know, to have a real scale design. So we encourage people to use the floor as a paper, and people can, you know, show us how big of the room that enough for the family, how big for the living room, how big for the bedroom. And this is one family try to measure how big for the bedroom that it should be. They have a kid to sleep here. And this is the husband, and this is the wife try to draw, you know, try to measure. And the people can measure it with the time. And this in Bangladesh, maybe in 2009 or 2010. When we're talking about new resettlement site, the people have some argument about how big of that plot, how big that's enough. You know, we need to clarify about the need and the demand. So we cannot do it in the scale paper or in the discussion on the plan. So we go to the field and, you know, measure the plot size according to the need of the people, and we try to find the minimum plot size that enough, you know, for the need, because we need to make the new resettlement site that can accommodate more people, like a 400 family in this project. So, you know, you can discuss about this, but the people will not get it, you know, because the people they understand it by action, by visualize it in the reality. So the very powerful process is, you know, you need to organize in the real space, so the people can send it clearly, so the argument will finish. And sometimes we need to make a real scale houses from the very simple material like a bamboo. In this way, the people they can, you know, relate to their need. They can relate to their own material. They can start dreaming about new house very clearly. It's very simple, and the people always love to make it the real scale model. You know, it's very, very powerful. And you can see this the landless people in Kopankan project in Bangladesh. When we start working, we visit where the people living. They used to have a community, but the government evicted them maybe 2-3 years ago to build a swimming pool or sports center. And then they have to be like this, like a homeless, no? And we met some women, and she, you know, we have a design process with many women from the landless network. So they share with us about the idea, how the new community that they like to be. So we got a lot of idea. And from that, we can develop a design and model from, you know, from the experience that we work with people, and from experience that we visit many local vernacular architecture, and we learn about the local material. So this new resettlement site that we developed for them, and from this design, we can got the land from the local government. And as you know, now we need to engage with nature more and more. So our work is not only engage with the people. You can realize that in your city or in the rural area, we have a lot of problem of pollution. For example, this is a project by John Todd. John Todd, he's a biologist who developed a living machine to treat the water pollution in different contexts. This is the canal in China, and he just used a native plant, you know, to treat the waters. So it's been like a 3 months, the water is become pure again from the nature system. And you know, we need to look at plant, the native plant, in different way. For example, we have a scientific knowledge about one big tree more than 10 years is give oxygen enough for 2 people per year. That means, you know, maybe in the new law or in the new principle of design to reduce a carbon footprint, maybe we need to, you know, calculate how much people in this village, and we need to grow more native tree, you know, to accompany us and to support the ecology system in the urban area. And this is the most cleanliness village in the world. It's in the northern of India, you know. So it's become the most cleanliness village in India because the people, they have a habit of when they wake up, the first thing they did, they start to clean their house, start to clean their neighbor area, their communities. And in the same community nearby that community, they build I don't know how to call this. It's the bridge built by the root of the tree. It's very amazing thing. So this is something that we need to look out of, you know, the normal way of how we think about design, planning, architecture, you know. If you know more about nature, you know more about the nature of the tree, about the thing, about ecosystem, maybe we can use it as a part of living architecture. It may spend like a 10 or 15 year to grow the breed like this, but it's sustained, and it's very unique, it have three important things, you know, when we organize the living process or co-creation. In the process, we, you know, they have three things that can allow the community or organization to organize itself more into the living system. The first thing, we should organize the process in the way we keep the people to have their own identity. We always, you know, come to the dialogue why we are doing this, you know, we discuss about why we are here, why you joining us. So in this way, the people start to clear about their identity. And the second thing is about the information. If we make the information that need for development in each state flow within the community or organization, in that way, the people will able to think properly, able to, you know, to use the information to determine what the action that they will take. And the last thing, we need to develop a relationship within the each process, because relationship is like a form of flow of energy, you know. When the people have a good relationship, they trust each other, all the work is easy, no matter what, no matter who they are. I will share with you two small projects, no, before co-creation process. The first project is about on-site upgrading in the southern part of Thailand in Kalatapae communities. This is a part of three regional. I think 90% of them are Muslim. this project I did in 2007 or 2005, long time ago. this is a photo of the settlement. This in the city actually, but it's in the periphery. They are one of the oldest communities, more than 150 years. They're living here as a fisher folk communities. But 100 years ago, the government start to have like a marine department. So they draw a artificial line here. So it means half of the community, they are illegal. They stay illegal and they faced eviction in 2005. So I start working with them and local government to find a way how to deal with the situation. And in the same city, they have another three community that are the fisher folk and stay in the same situation, you know, in the marine department. So for this community, they have like 300 houses in 8-acre land. They stay 450 years. So when you go to the local government office, you ask for the community map. So they give you this map. That means it's the map without the half of the communities because it's illegal. So it's not their job to make them. A community map. So we start the first job by do the survey and mapping to make the community that stay here for 150 years visible. So this is the existing communities. They are the fisher folk community. 80% of them still working as a fisherman. So because we have like 3 months to prepare for the development plan to propose to the local government. So we need very quick process to do mapping and design and planning with people. So I asked them at the beginning how can we make the mapping in the very fast way. So they said, oh, we have a different land, different footpath, and we organize ourselves according to the footpath, and they have like a 21 footpath. That means it's a 21 subgroup. They suggest that we can make a survey and mapping according to that subgroup, and we will make the whole community map together. And it spent just 3 days. We complete the whole mapping in the real scale, no? Of 300 houses. So when we measure the house, we guide the people to make a map into a scale of 1 to 100. And then I help them to, you know, make a scale into a smaller one so we can discuss about the whole community development. So they have a main issue about the government claim that they occupy the river. So we need to reclaim the land. We need to go to the aerial photograph department to, you know, look back to the oldest aerial photograph and start to trace the line like a 50 year back where they are. Then we need to cut some part of the house and we make a footpath. And the footpath in this line will be it can be a pier for the boat as well. And we find out it have a sand dune here where the people use it as a public space. And people use it to, you know, to maintain their boat, to dry the fish. So the people have an idea to develop this as a, like a community park for the city people can also use it. And then I leave the homework for people to make where to put the footpath. So the blue one is the is mean the footpath is good. They don't need to build it. So it already a good wood or it can made by concrete, but it's very strong. So they don't need to destroy it. So the red one is like a new footpath that they want to build and connect to each house and also bring the water supply and electricity to each house. And the yellow one, that means the house that need to cut some part to open for the food part. So this very detailed and it's done within 1 month since the beginning. And then I help them to develop the idea for the public space that they want. They share with us, they want a small school together with the mosque for their community. And also other people can use it because their community don't have public space anymore. They need a playground, they need a area where they can repair their boat together. They need the area where they can bring a small fish to fish here. But sometimes they catch a fish or sea animal, but it's still a baby. They want to put it here so they can grow and they can sell later. So we make a model, and then actually it's a long process. After that, we need a negotiation with the marine department and local government, but with the process that people understand and they have clear vision how the future they want. So they themselves is very strong force to talk to the media, talk to the local politician, and then they got the right to stay. So you can see, you know, the people live like that as an informal for 100 years, and they are illegal. But you know, with the process that we work together, just within 3 months, it's empowered people to see clearer how their future will be. And it's not only vision, but they also want, they also take action toward that as well. So after 2 years of the project, they got the funding from CODI to develop their infrastructure and repair a house. And yeah, at the end, they got a permission to stay here and develop infrastructure. So this like the foot path that they built as a pier as well. So the boat can stop here in the monsoon. This is the mosque, and underground they use it as a school for the kids to learn religious. They have playground, and this is the bridge that they cross to the public space. So this public space take care by the community, but everyone can use it. So they develop a new relationship with the other people in the city. So the kid has a new open space to play. They have more friends from other part of the city because this is like a very dense part of the city, very own that part of the city. So many kids came here with the parents to the mosque every Friday. And then the development from the community is not stopped when the infrastructure and they finish all the physical building. So they encourage the kids to form a garbage recycling group because they always have a garbage flow from the river, you know, so they can got a lot of garbage and they can, you know, separate it and then they sell it. This is the part of saving group as well. And every month they have a gathering to clean the cemetery nearby their communities. So they try to create the process to develop their community together. They use the event of cleaning community every month, maybe after the Friday prayer, and then they gathering, they clean the cemetery, they clean the village, they clean the public space, and they have a tea or have a dinner together. So it's like a new culture to gathering, to maintain their community, to discuss about the problem, discuss about the good thing. So development can be part of their new way of living, new way of culture, you know. It's not just event, or it's not just the sake of development. And before the monsoon, the people will start to maintain their riverbank because to prevent the flood. So, you know, they be part of the solution for the city as well. And they work with the local government. And this next project will show you about the resettlement project, which is I and T working with Women for the World in Myanmar in 2010. I think it's quite special about this housing project. You can see it. This is the living of the people. Most of them are landless, no? When we work in Yangon in 2010. So this quite normal process. Before you work, you need to know where people living, what they are doing, how much they have, what they love about their place, what they don't like, what is the problem. You know, you make a tour to their community, make a tour to their workplace. So this is the job of the poor people. They have a variety of jobs. And because at that time it's still in the martial law, no? So actually foreigner like me and they cannot go to the community, but somehow we can manage to work in the temple in the landless community in Lantaya. And we need to do a very quick process. Normally when I organize the design process for upgrading or for resettlement, at least it needs seven days or 10 days. So in this way, nothing can promise that we can work like that. So we try to shorten the process as much as we can. So within 3 days, we need to, you know, to work with people in the work with landless network in Yangon and come up with some idea. So that's a big challenge. So I need to think differently. You know, I need to discuss with our friend and our community every step, how we do this and in the quick way, you know. So at the beginning, we ask people a basic information and we ask them about the dream house, dream communities. The people from different community, they start to share their dream house, their dream community, the thing that they need, how much they can afford, where is the land that possible for them to buy, and it's good for them to stay for the future. So this just happened only one day. Very intensive. We have, you know, stay together from morning to the evening. So we start to develop a site planning and have a dialogue with them. And then it's emerged that people curious about how big of 8 feet, how big of 15 feet, they don't understand it. So we start to, you know, make the real measurement, and we train the women to use the measurement tape. It's a lot of fun in this process, but it take a break from the, you know, drawing, talking into action. And then we try to measure the plot in the different plot size from the people idea, and we come up with like a 15-30 that is big enough for everyone and not too big so they can buy the land. So we come up with the final simple plan for 20 houses, like a 20 feet by 40 feet. But when I walk in the community at the first day, I realized that if we set back from the street for the future business, maybe it can benefit for the community. So I asked the community people, does it possible to keep 2 feet for the public in the front? So if everyone can have a business, small business area here, or if they don't sell anything, they can rent it to other people. So final plot will be 18 by 40 and everyone agree. And this girl is the architect, real architect. Maybe her past life is an architect for sure. She came with her mom and she just have no doubt to draw dream house. The women and the own the people tell her what to draw. You know, she start to draw according to the women tell. And then she also understand how to make a scale model very quickly, and she teach other women how to make a model. And this is on the last day, on the third day, we can come up to the model, you know, how the people want to live. For me, to make a model is very important. People can visualize it and they can think about the public space, water supply, how to build a house, and where to put the toilet. The yellow one is a toilet. The orange one is like some houses, they have animal shed, like a chicken or pig. The green one is a vegetable farm. So we start to have a dialogue through the model making. And then we spend like another day to cut a model to show the variety of house. If they are the relative, they can join the wall together. If they have a small family, they can build small like this. And this is the area where they can make a business for the future. And then I want to make a drawing to show them how beautiful it is, their dream. So I just go to have a tea in the market, and I met this artist. He came to sell a postcard to me, and his water painting is beautiful. And then I show him a photo of the model. I talk with him about the project that we work. He really appreciate, and he want to work for free, but actually he also landless, no? And then we hire him to make a perspective drawing for us. So he draw this two photo within 2 days. It's very beautiful. This is like a dream community that the people want. They have a share water pump together in one cluster. They will grow a lot of big tree, fruit tree. They have a chicken for their income as well. So, and then when we came back to Thailand, we keep develop some design. And we start working with engineer at that time. The people start saving. And then they find a land plot site. We support their funding from ACCA project. No? And then they're gathering a community builder. And this the project after 1 year. Maybe this is the very fastest housing project. And it may look like a temporary, but you can see. This is the cheapest housing project that we did maybe in the world. I don't know. This is just $300. The people have to pay for land and housing. That's why the house it looks temporary, but for the people, it's no problem because they own it together. We have a collective saving group. We have an idea of have a collective land. The people cannot sell. If they want to sell, they sell to the saving group. So the reason that we make $300 because of, you know, from the research and information, the people can pay back, can save money only 20 jars, it's around $20 per month. So we will decide the how and plan according to affordable, because they don't have any system yet in Myanmar to support the poor people. We need to show the new system. It's not to show the architectural project. We want to show a new system where the people can build their own life, build their own communities. Then the beauty and the design can incremental, you know, in that sense. And as an architect and planner, engineer, we can see a lot of things we can help the people to develop for a better housing project. But this, at that time, 10 years ago, is affordable and it's quite interesting. And I keep working with Myanmar. I went back every year and see a development. The people, they save the money to build a water pump together among 6 houses. They maintain together because this they're saving money. And they start to grow trees. And in this in 2012, some houses, they start, they when they get more saving. You know, they buy a new wood, they change the bamboo to the wood. And then when they stay for 3 years, they start to build a community center because they have a lot of visitor, a lot of organization, university, from foreigner to visit their project. Because this is the first project ever in Myanmar history where the people gathering and work together and build a community by themselves. And this in 2013, and this in 2016, you see the people, they grow the tree, the fruit tree. And many university, many workshop is, you know, visit this community. And this 2016. And this in 2019, when we organize co-creation workshop in Yangon, you can see from the bamboo hut, the people, they develop this community for 10 years. So they, you know, it's not true that the people, the poor people cannot pay, because from our experience, our research, the people always pay, you know, for their rent the land or rent the house, at least, you know, more than 30,000 jat or maybe more than 30 US dollar per month. They need to pay for rent the house, rent the room, rent the land, and pay for basic infrastructure. But that money go for private development. It never go to community development. So how can we, you know, make a new system where those money can manage for their own development? And this is an incremental design. And at the end, they can change the design, the planning according to the need. And this is the most cheapest housing. You cannot make a cheapest house by thinking only the material and the design. You know, you need to think about the time, the process, about the life, you know, life changing according to the circumstance. And then the house should change and shape from the time and the living within the house as well. And then the savings still develop a new system, you know. The more they have more member, the more they have more saving program for income, for welfare, for housing. They develop a new system. They develop a new leadership. So this is a living system, you know, that they decide themselves. And at the beginning, I observed many informal settlement. They have a pig. Almost every house have one pig, you know, like a mother pig. So I curious about the economic of it. So when I start to go in the detail, you know, how much for the pig, how long that they feed the pig, where the food came from, you know, I start to realize the pig is like a saving system for the family. You can see from the research in 2010, one small pig, mother pig like this, is called like 20,000 jat. You feed it for 6 months with food from the restaurant, you know. Then you can sell like 200 jat, like a 10 times of the beginning. So 200,000 jat, when you grow it like 6 months, you can sell the baby, and that become an income for you, you know, after 6 months. And from that income from one mother pig, you can pay back for the housing project. And you also have a saving, like a 10 jat per month. You pay back for housing for 20 jat. So, but in the urban area, the neighbor will not allow you to have a pig. So because it's, you know, it's smelly. So we organize a workshop with them how to make a biogas from a simple material, just like a within maybe 50 US dollar, we can build a simple biogas system. I invite my friend who are the engineer who work with the farmer in Thailand, who are the expert on, you know, biogas technology, and we organize the workshop in Yangon. We invite many community to join, and they start to develop this to build a biogas so they can have a pig farm, not pig farm, they can have like a, they can have a have a pick, maybe few pick, like a pick 5 or 10, not more than 10, they can make a biogas. And from the beginning that we developed a housing project in 2010 until now, they keep working together, you know, and then they can build a new system with the local government and national government. So they got a policy of to build a 600 or 6,000 units. The government provide a land in Yangon in 3 different township, and they start to talking about the new legal framework to have a collective land ownership. I think it's very progress. That happened from the, you know, from the small project that we start in 2010. But that's a living process, living system where they can grow, where they can open to the new environment, to the new stakeholder. We start to build a new system that failure to life to provide support and stability, to provide more freedom for individual to experiment. This is important. In the living process, it needs the freedom for individual to explore and experiment. So only that the new system can emerge from individual experimentation. And before 2016, before we develop co-creation, actually I myself go into a different practice. Many of you may know that I'm also a yoga teacher. I practiced yoga for 10 years. And it makes me confident in the knowledge that we have in the body. Actually, your body know a lot about yourself. The body, every cell have a lot of memory about yourself, about the way to solve the problem. But we use only, you know, the memory from the thought. We not co-create with our body. So that's why I focus a lot on body movement, or bring the people to the side, bring people to walk, you know, because in that way you can activate the wisdom from the cell, from the body, from the environment. And that give me a clue of something new about the process between participation and co-creation. Co-creation is about, you know, when you start to develop a present moment, when you start to forget about yourself and then you embrace everything, that is the state that don't have you yourself, don't have you as a center. In participation, maybe you have a role of community architect, a role of you to facilitate, to hold this and that. But in co-creation, you awake and you are be part of everything else. You are more subtle and you are, you know, you sometimes it's speakable, but you link with other things and then it start to dance together. So the body knowledge is important thing that I want to tell you. If you need to do co-creation, you need to be very strong in body and mind. You need some practice, exercise, good food. And then I came across my teacher from Finhorn community in 2014 and 15. Judy McAllister, she's a second generation in Finhorn. She used to be a director in Finhorn communities. Finhorn community is in Scotland. Many of you may know about Finhorn community. They are the spiritual ecology community that start 50 years back. And Judy came to Thailand to teach us about co-creation with nature. So the first time I heard about co-creation is from Finhorn community, you know, where the founder start to work with the natural wisdom. So I think this is a turning point that I can send up some new process emerge within the network that we work together with people and nature. So I start to call it co-creation. And I will show you 4 co-creation that we start in the network. The first one we start in Chum Sang. in the upper north of Bangkok. This is Bangkok, and in the red dot is the Chum Sang in Nakhon Sawan. Why we start here in 2016? In 2016, Cody have a program to develop a citywide upgrading that includes other part of city. It's not only urban poor community, but they want to experiment the new idea how the city people can decide their own city, and urban poor community can be a core part of design and planning. So housing is like a one issue of citywide upgrading, but they want to open to the new development and to work with authority. And we survey many cities in Thailand, but we realize that Chum Sang is one of the very interesting, because the city like Chum Sang is maybe 200 cities like this, the small city that close to the big city, where the young people migrate to work in the big city, and they left the own people and the kid live in the city like this. And the city like this, they have a own history like 100 years from the riverside settlement. So I think it's good to demonstrate in this kind of city, because it is a replicate. It can represent many cities like this in Thailand. And you can see it's a very small town. You know? The boundary between the city and the agriculture area is still close. You know, they have a one river go through the city. They have 8,000 or 9,000 people. Almost 30% are elderly. And yeah, I think this kind of scale give us a very important thing, because the people know each other for the whole city. The scale of like a 4,000 unit, you know, when we talk about this, how the people know where they are. When they talk about this family name, they know where they live. You know, this is quite interesting, and they live here for more than 150 years. They have their own cultures, from the Chinese migrant mixed with the Thai people, with ethnic people. So we spent like a 3 months, or sorry, 6 months for prepare the workshop. So I think we organized a small workshop to bring all the group in the city to talk together, to find the issue, to find the problem, to find the thing that they're proud about their city. So we also visit each group activity. We visit the important housing project. We visit the historical area. So we start to send that how to organize the workshop. So from the discussion, from many group of the people, they have like a 6 issue. The first one is about the city planning policy, how to make it inclusive, how to make it possible for community network to be part of city planning. And they have a issue of heritage and culture. They have a own market, they have a own history that link with the national history. And they have a group, a cycling group that's quite famous in Thailand. So they want to develop a better road network, public space, and the friendly for cycling, especially for the kids to cycling to their school. And we have a group of housing and communities, and we have a group of health, because they have a lot of kids and elderly, so they want to develop a city in the way it's more healthy for the kids and elderly. And also they have the group about water ecology and food security, how to bring back the ecology to the city. That's why we don't use the area base to work. We use the issue base, where different group of people can work together. So we want to try this way. if we work in the area base, maybe this area belong to the red shirt, this area belong to the yellow shirt, it's difficult to go across the political polarization. So I will show you the documentary film about the workshop.
เมืองชุมแสงนี่สมัยก่อนมีดีหลายอย่างการค้าขายข้าวอุดมสมบูรณ
์สิ่งดีๆก็คือมีเจ้าพ่อเจ้าแม่ชุมแสงเป็นที่นับถือของชาวชุมแสงนะนะ
อาหารการกินดีอากาศดีผู้คนก็รู้จักกัน
สมัยก่อนคนมันเยอะนะก็ขายดีขายวันเป็น 17,000-8,000 แต่สมัยนี้มันไม่มีแล้วหมดสมัย
เดี๋ยวนี้มันไม่ได้แล้วคือชุมแสงนี่นะครับมีแต่คนแก่กับเด็กพวกที่หนุ่มสาวก็ไปทำงานที่อื่นหมด
แล้วคนแก่หลายคนก็ไม่อยากไปอยู่กับลูกหลานเท่าไหร่เพราะที่นี่มีความสุขกว่ามีเพื่อนบ้านเหมือนสวรรค์ของคนแก่
แทนครั้งนี้เรามากันที่ชุมแสงก่อนหน้านี้เราทำงานกับชุมชนมาก่อนมันก็จะมีขนาดเล็กพอมาสเกลเนี้ยมันใหญ่ขึ้นประเด็นมันก็เยอะขึ้นซับซ้อนขึ้นความเชื่อมโยงของประเด็นก็เยอะขึ้นซึ่งเราใช้เครื่องมือการสนับสนุนให้ชุมชนเนี่ยสามารถถ่ายทอดความต้องการถ่ายทอดความคิดของตัวเองได้ที่สำคัญคือว่าชุมชนเนี่ยมีความสามัคคีความผูกพันในชุมชนก็ยังมีอยู่พอมันมีความสัมพันธ์อย่างนี้อยู่ในพื้นที่แล้วเนี่ยมันทำให้เราสามารถเข้าไปทำงานได้ง่ายเราก็ช่วยกันตีโจทย์ช่วยกันร่วมออกแบบให้มันกลายเป็นโปรเจกต์กลายเป็น proposal ที่เราสามารถนำไปเสนอกับทางภาครัฐหรือทางคนข้างบนได้
ที่หนึ่งนะฮะนโยบายการมีส่วนร่วม5วันนี้ใช่ไหมครับท่านนายกมาอยู่กับเราตลอดน้องๆตัวเล็กๆก็ยังอยู่กับเรานะฮะพี่ๆพ่อๆแม่ๆนี่ไม่ต้องพูดถึงเลยนะครับ
เราคุยกันประชุมกันแล้วลงไปดูพื้นที่วันนี้เราอาจจะชวนกันปั่นต่อไปเราอาจจะพาไปสู่นโยบายการใช้รถใช้ถนนบางครั้งเราอาจจะเดินผ่านไปผ่านมาขี่จักรยานมอเตอร์ไซค์รถยนต์เราเห็นว่าเส้นทางนี้น่าปั่นแต่เราไม่เคยปั่น
เป็นว่ามีเราจะสร้างเมืองนี้ให้เป็นเมืองชุมแสงร่วมกับธรรมชาติ
ลองไล่กันดูว่าเราคิดอะไรกันได้บ้างอันนี้เป็นสิ่งที่เป็นไอเดียมาหมดเลยบางอย่างมาจากน้องๆบางอย่างมาจากพี่ๆเราเอามารวมกันแล้วเราวาดให้คนสามารถเห็นภาพได
้ถ้าเกิดว่าเราปลูกต้นไม้ถ้าเราจัดพื้นที่มันจะเป็นยังไง
เมืองชุมแสงนะคะจะต้องสุขภาพดีคือถนนเนี่ยนะคะว่าเราจะปลูกอะไรดีเนี่ยแกะได้ถ้าเพื่อนๆไม่ชอบใจออกมาแกะได้เลยค่ะน้องๆก็ทำให้แกะวางใหม่ได้แล้วจากนั้นเราก็มาปรับปรุงในแผนที่นะครับอันนี้เราก็ตั้งชื่อง่ายๆว่าแผนที่ของดีเมืองชุมแสง
มีของดีของเด่นอ่ะจริงๆมันมีเต็มไปหมดเลยจะมีใครที่มาขายของได้มากกว่า30ปีอันนี้มันทำให้เราแบบไม่ตื่นตาตื่นใจ
แล้วเดี๋ยวเรามานั่งคุยกันว่าแต่ละหมวดหมู่เนี่ยอะไรสาระที่เราจะต้องทำก่อนอะไรซ้อลงมาแล้วผมก็จะเอาเป็นแผนพัฒนาทำให้ชุมแสงเป็นเมืองหน้าอยู่ขอบคุณอีกครั้งขอบคุณอีกครั้ง
แคนโคเครียดเนี่ยชื่อมันมีความสำคัญมากมันไม่ใช่ว่าใครจะเป็นคนนำใครจะเป็นคนจูงอีกฝ่ายเดินมันคือการมาอยู่แล้วก็การจัดการการพัฒนาความคิดไม่ว่าจะเป็นคนนอกคนในภาครัฐเนี่ยก็จะมาทำงานด้วยกันในแนวราบแล้วก็ตอนจบนี่เราก็มีการหาความร่วมมือดูกันว่าโปรเจกต์ไหนจะสามารถเกิดขึ้นได้จริงโปรเจกต์ไหนยากโปรเจกต์ไหนเริ่มได้เลยเริ่มก่อนโปรเจกต์ไหนยากหน่อยต้องใช้เวลาเราค่อยๆวางแผนก้าวไปซึ่งผมว่านี้เป็นสิ่งที่สำคัญ
I think this workshop is really really nice experience because it gives more practical and we learn a lot from the local community and the local community also learn from us and I believe that after this workshop there will be very nice collaboration.From the people and the government as one, so I really, really think this is very important process to make Chum Saeng a better city.
This type of workshop, CAN workshop, is not ordinary workshop. I mean, traditional workshop is that you plan, then people take it. But here, you question. You know, you question. People also question. In the end, maybe no solution.It's very different the way we organize. We don't know most of the things from the beginning, but we are from the similar orientation that we work with people. So in this type of workshop, people can touch people's heart.
เราเห็นภาพการทำงานในที่นี้นะคะว่าทุกคนที่มาร่วมเวิร์กช็อปทั้งคณะกรรมการหรือว่าชาวบ้านเนี่ยทุกคนเท่าเทียมกันจริงๆ
ก็มันไม่เป็นทฤษฎีอ่ะมันเป็นแบบความเข้าใจแล้วอย่างก็เหมือนได้ทำให้เรามองเห็นภาพง่ายๆที่จะทำให้ชุมแสงมันฟื้นตัวขึ้น
Thank you.
you can see, you know, the way we design the workshop. You know, actually, we cannot design the whole 5 day, but we set a flow. You know, we need to adjust it from time to time. But I think I can, when I look back to the 5 day workshop of maybe more than 120 people, different discipline, different country, you know, come together, I can see the like a three different process. Actually, I adopt this from my yoga principle. You know, when you practice yoga, you need like a three state of one posture. First is grounding. The second, you need to hold the posture for some time for your body to start to work with it from a different level, from the outer level into a inside, into the subtle level. And at the end, you need to relax to return to the real nature of you, you know. So I think these three principles we adapt to the co-creation workshop. The first 2 days is grounding into understanding about ourselves, who we are and who they are, what is the context, what is the culture, what is the issue. And we understand it not only by thinking, but we experience it. We eat with people, you know, we talk with people, we try to communicate with people, you know. So we grounding in the reality of ourselves and the surrounding and the people, the cultures. So it's important to decide the group work that have variety of like gender, discipline, and we need a local people to mix gender, age, discipline. We need a community architect, you know, from local as a host, and we need like a senior community architect, young professional, you know, to mix. We need local government in one group, in one issue. But more important, we need the people to choose the group work by themselves. We will not choose for them. You know, this is very, very crucial because, you know, the people have to know what they want to create. That the first question, the basic thing. Maybe they're not sure about which group they want to go, but they need to send, they need to trust their send, because that's the way they can use their own wisdom. Without that, they cannot send the other thing. They cannot send the reality, because every one of us have a different expertise. So we will bring very important creativity to contribute to the group. And for Chum Sang, we keep the group work for the whole 5 day. No? We have 6 different issues. And the second part will be holding on the third and the fourth day, you know. We looking for the issue, we looking for the site to work, and then we decide the catalyst project, or we call it acupuncture project, the project that can activate the whole system, the project that practical enough, you know, to start with. We don't need a fancy dreamy project. We need something that practical, but that practical project link with the whole system, you know. So the first 2 days guide you the whole system, and then the second 2 days you need to go deep to find where is the door to implement the vision. And on the last day, it will be sharing session, presentation. I call it the relaxed moment, where you can, you know, listen and appreciate your work, appreciate about the people. I think the mood of the workshop will change on the end of the day. You know, we need a relaxation for us to come back to what we know and start to integrate what we don't know. You know, it's very important. And everywhere I have a seed of co-creation. For example, in Chum Sang, I ask people, what is the thing they have been doing together for the whole city? They never do a city planning together, but they have a ceremony of like their own god and goddess that protect the city, you know, for more than 100 years, more than 127 years. And they said every kid in the Chumsang city have to learn how to perform this dance. It's a sacred dance. No? It's not just like a dance for beauty, but it's a sacred dance that they will organize every year to celebrate the god and goddess that protect the city. So in that dance, it involves a lot of people in the city, you know. So this kind of thing is like the seed of co-creation. So we can we can bring this quality into the in our process. That means, you know, they already know how to work together with different age, you know, different gender, you know. So they have this kind of environment, so we can adopt this into a city planning. That's why we design a workshop in the big stadium. It's like a exhibition hall, it's like a festival, you know. And after the workshop, people start to gathering and discuss what they will continue from the workshop. This is the group of culture and heritage. They want to collect their own photo and archive of the city to develop a museum. And they have like a very interesting, simple event. Every Sunday, they will invite the elderly from different area to walk together in their own market and like encourage people to clean the house and make a garden in front of the house. And they also listen to the elderly, what is the need they want, you know. It's like a city rally that they appreciate the city and they listening to the people what they need. They also have a local government to walk with them. This idea emerged from the workshop, and the elderly can walk together. It's like an exercise as well. And the government, they want to develop further the idea from our group that, you know, they want to make the people appreciate the riverside after they make a retaining wall. The people cannot see the river anymore. So they want to develop like a simple spot for the people to come and eat, or the kid can make, can do their homework here. And this donation from the people from Chumsang communities. And they want to develop like a reading spot, like this kind of small project emerged after the workshop. And many university visit Chumsang. This is the professor from Chulalongkorn University from architectural and planning school. They brought a student from urban planning department to visit Chumsang to listen from the people. The people become a professor. They told the professor about how they design the city, what is the idea, you know. So the people are more open to the professional like architect and planner to help them in the future planning of Chumsang City. And the people also part of a city planning committee after the workshop. And they change the environment of working in the local government department. They always ask the people what to do before the festival. So they encourage to use their own motive, no? of the mass of dance that they have. And the cycling group is very famous. They already famous before we met them, but after the workshop, you know, many television, many cycling group in Thailand and abroad came to Chumsang and, you know, cycling with them, let them be the guide to visit a very beautiful place and nature in Chumsang. And more people participate in cycling and they keep an important role on develop the road connection, how to make Chumsang is a friendly cycling city. And some school teacher, they got an idea after the workshop, you know, to bring the equipment that normally in the school, but they bring it to the public, where this is like a, I don't know how to say it, but they have a kind of some star happen in that day. So the school teacher and children, they organize this. So they try to make a public space alive when at night, you know, where the kid and the elderly can come and enjoy to see the star and discuss about the star and talking about other things. This like a small, simple activity, and they have an art exhibition from different schools organized in the public space where the kid and the elderly can enjoy and appreciate their children art, you know. And then in 2018, we moved to co-create in Pontianak in the Indonesia. We work with the new community architect group. It's a part of ARCOM, our friend network in Indonesia. We work in Beting. Beting is one of the very old city in Pontianak, maybe the beginning of the city. And the first thing we appreciate is eating, you know, we eating together with the young team. This is the new community architect who just started that group in Pontianak. And you can see Beting is like the city in the waters. There are more than, I think more than 4,000 houses in the city. They have a long history, maybe 300 year back. Or 600 years back, I forgot. It's the mosque, the old mosque that they still maintain. It's different workshop because we work with the new team. So they may not have experience, but they have energy to search for the issue, have the energy to try something new, have the energy to connect with new people. I think this is bring a very good quality to the workshop. So we might not clear about the issue at the beginning. It's different from Chumsang that we have time to prepare and we find a group to work and to plan for the city. But in Pontianak, we don't clear about who will be the group of people that will make change for their own community and their own city. We met only young architects and then we're searching for the local people that want to make change and the issue. So the flow is the same with three steps, but the way we organize the group is different. At the first 2 days, we divide our group according to the area in four different zones. So we can go to the site, talk with the people, observe the issue. And then after 2 days, we got some issue and we divide our group into the issue base. So we found that the waste management is the key to everything and the people quite interested in the issue of how to manage the waste from the short term and long term. So we divide the four groups of waste management, short term, you know, something that we can do it right now during the workshop with the different group of people and with the local government. And we have a group that planning for waste management and community upgrading for the midterm and long term, and also thinking about the policy, because the government have a policy to develop a Beting as a riverfront, riverside eco city. You know, it's a good concept, but how to collaborate with people idea. And then we have a group of young people to work with the media and advocacy about the history of Beting, the good thing about Beting, about how to manage the waste management together. And the last group will deal with the case study about waste management in the Indonesia and in the global, how they deal with waste management. So this is a four group that we keep working from the last 3 days. So from the beginning that we're not clear who are the people that want to make change in the communities. We found the key people, the mothers that care about their community and they know each other. They know their community, they know the history. So they start to step out and work with us. They share the idea about how to manage waste, how to upgrade the communities. And on the last day after presentation, we organize the waste cleaning, the garbage cleaning in the canal near the workshop area. I think this is about powerful. It's very important to take action, and we have a direction how to manage in the midterm, how to engage with the government. But without action with the people, I think it's we lost the energy. It's like the way we anchor the energy of co-creation in the community, and we make it visible. We make it into the body experience. These are crucial for me. And yeah, in Indonesia, they call it Gotong Royong. You know, Gotong Royong is mean co-creation in their language. When we talk about Gotong Royong, people know very well what it means. And it's calling them quality of co-creation, you know. And something that I like a lot is like a contemplation or meditation for me. Every day when we go to work in Beijing, you know, we stay in another side of the river. We need to walk from the hotel, go through the park, very, very nice park. And then we took a boat, the boat from the people, from the community. They came and took us across the big river every day. And at the end of the day, we crawled back to our hotel. So for me, it's like a contemplative or meditative space before the work and after the work. This is very beautiful moment. And in that silent and very wide river, I think it's make me connect with something deeper than my thought. And I always have a new idea every morning when I cross the river, and I feel relaxed every time when I go back from that thing. And this is the third co-creation in Jenaida in 2018 in Bangladesh. It's hosted by our friend, community architect friend in Jenaida. So from the preparation, they did a great work of, you know, community upgrading citywide survey, and they make a great work to link with the local government. So they bring this idea to discuss among the different group of people in Jenaida, how can they co-create, organize the co-creation process. So it's and the map showed the new possibility. You know, they have a river, they have public space, they have a lot of pond, they have a lot of nature in the city. How Jenaida can, you know, co-create a new vision to live together with the existing that they have. This is the workshop. I like the idea that they put the workshop in the middle of every site. So we can walk from the hotel to the workshop place, and then we can walk to the site from the workshop place, and it's close to the market. We can go for ice cream and eating or tea. You know, it's very lively in the walking distance. So this is the very ideal way to set the workshop place, and it's in front of the local government. So that makes sure the government will come and join us anytime that they have a free time. And this keep for free, you know, the venue and electricity, water supply, whatever is a part of, you know, co-create together. So this is a very good example of how to organize and partnership with the local government, local group. So I will share with you the documentary about co-creation in Jenaida.
It's a very good beginning that if the community people can design or co-create their own community, why not the whole city people can design their own city?
about this co-creation workshop. We start with urban poor communities first. And the community, this is the oldest low-income community, and they are the poorest one, but they are organizing their community. They are doing a lot of things. They are teaching other people. So then we did small workshops with kids, we sat with elderly people, we sat with community people. Then every group actually mentioned about their dreams. All of them discuss about open space and good road, good pedestrian to walk. Then again, it was a surprise us that the people also got confidence that yeah, we can do it. And we always call it network. So from that moment, we started to connect with city people more.
We actually invited all the groups we could sit, and they would actually link us to other groups. And the young people, they have so many energy. They are talking about the action. And we know they can actually take it forward even without the organization. So that's how. And we try to reach academia, then who is in the action, who are in the research, and every field.
My group works with this community. We also want to know about their story. What is the important to them? What is their skill? So all these things we can see the connection with the city because they are part of the city.
I'm working with the River and Open Space group. So basically we trying to find alternative routes. How can we go to the river? So at first we choose a group of children who can help us to find the way out, what kind of riverside or what kind of pond they envision.
I worked in the group for the road and open places design. We talked to all the people who are using the roads. So we proposed separate road for bicycle and pedestrian. And we proposed area where the road can become the public space for the city.
They want that their city road will be greenery, colorful with flowers, and they want that city should be clean.
I think in the process of co-creation, we should not forget to go deep. We need to be very focused and clear, but also need to make sure that we include. So I feel we all need to support each other and walk together on that path, and it is possible to do.
So when we did the workshop and when we showed it to the city mayor and the DC, they understand. They could understand when they were outside. They could see and walk on the path and they could see the people. Then we walked to that jail area, the path through the river. Immediately he said that, yeah, this is possible. So in this workshop, I think if they are connected with respect and do something together, then it can be implemented.
I feel people have energy, they want to do things. They always say, this is a platform where everyone is equal, you know, there is no up and down. So the magic moment for me was how the community presented. They learned the language of negotiation. It sparked my heart. So from this platform, many things can actually go, and we can actually do this together.
Chalo Jinaidaguri.
10 মিলে জিনেদা শহর গড়ি
উই ক্যান কো-ক্রিয়েট জিনেদা
উই ক্যান কো-ক্রিয়েট জিনেদা
10 মিলে জিনেদা গড়ি
10 মিলে জিনেদা গড়ি
10 মিলে জিনেদা শহর গড়ি
So you can get the energy from the film. No? It's have a lot of moment that we learn the new thing. You can observe that in the workshop. We open for all kind of technique and method, different way of presentation. You know, we just need to have a direction, but the way they will answer to the direction, I think we make it up to the small group discussion or up to the personal interpretation, so we can see the variety of messages that go to the same direction, and people feel free to, you know, to learn from each other how to color it or how to make a model. You know, we don't have a clear boundary of the group work. When we finish our group work, we go to another group work to help them. You know, it's more friendly, the whole group work, and you know, we collaborate with the local people, with the local government. We try to create an environment where we can trust, where we can respect everyone. Even the kids that work with us, they are very important. You know, we take everyone in the same respect. And you can see how powerful it is when the people present what they think, what they dream, what they contribute to the presentation themselves. And they have a new language of how to present about the dream urban planning. You know, it's very beautiful, very artistic, but it conveys a lot of sense, a lot of dream. So in this workshop, we develop a lot of model, a lot of experience, a lot of contemplative space where we can like quiet, where we can listening, where we can share the poetry. I think this very new and very fresh, unknown process, but it all is great and a quality to the co-creation. And many people bring their family, you know, to join in the festival, not festival, in the exhibition. I think that's very warm feeling, you know, that they're talking about their own city, they're talking about their future, you know, development of their city, of their history. I think it's very powerful. And we walk a lot in this co-creation. We visit the jail area, and the mayor share experience when he was in jail, you know. It's a lot of good story that connect us. We try to develop a real experience, and I think to develop a real scale development, like the pedestrian group try to make a real rearrangement of new pedestrian and crossroad. I think they will face a difficulty, but in that difficulty, they make them more realistic about what they will propose. What is the important thing that they want to do? What is the key thing? What is the essence message that they want to convey to the people? Very powerful, you know, when you show to the people, how about we arrange the place like this? It's just simple, easy, possible, and it feels totally better. It's like a new pedestrian system. But you don't need to do a lot of things. You just rearrange it, have some rule or regulation, have a new culture to use the space, have new respect, you know, have new collaboration, contribution from everyone that be part of this space. Everything is just organized in a half day, you know, for this group. Almost every group helping this group to make it real. And then it's pay back to ourselves when on the last day, the people quite appreciate and get what we want to do. And they see the role from different position as mayor or local government or architect. You know, we realize the law, the role where we will contribute to what we dream. I think these are more important. And for the flow of co-creation in Jenaida, I think we keep the group work the same since the beginning, from the community upgrading, riverside and public space and road and pedestrian. Yeah. That's why it makes us go deep into each issue and we come up with a lot of solution and idea from the different state, short term, midterm and long term. But you can do this because of you have a good preparation before the workshop. You develop a good relationship with the local government, with the civil society, with another group in the city, with the young people. And this is the last co-creation that we did in Yangon. These are more focused on the housing and city development in South Dakong, one of the township, the industry township in Yangon. We want to show the new way of working with housing and city development together, not separate the housing project and urban development project. So we visit the housing project that have been doing from the last 10 years with the Women for the World and Women Group Network to learn how they build their housing, what is their obstacle, what is their success, what is their suggestion. And we visit the community in South Dakong that not yet developed or not yet have a saving group. And during the workshop, we need to have a break. You know, when you work very intense in the workshop, you need a break to go to some place that give you energy and, you know, peacefulness and lively. So we go to Shwe Dakong, one of the very important pagoda and history of Myanmar. It gives us a lot of space and, you know, relaxation to walk around the pagoda. And during the workshop, when we visit the community, we always get a seed of co-creation. This is like the donation that the community will share their money, they will share the money, share the equipment for the monk during the long rainy season where the monk have to stay in the temple. So they have this long culture, you know, for the community to support the monk and the temple by co-create, share the resource to support the religions. And yeah, we realize that the poor, actually they can pay, they have, but we need to manage how to set a new development system where, what is the mechanism where they can own it, where they can create it, not the system where someone imposed to them. So in that way, they can use their money that used to go to the private development into their own community and city development. So we go deep to the detail of who are they, how many people who are living in the South Dakong, how big of the land. So during the workshop, we use the fact finding with people to shape the framework of the city development and the workshop. So a lot of data is came from local government, from the industrial association, from the community network, from the NGO, from the academy, from the young people that participate with us, and mixed with the experience that we have from different countries. In one group work, we have, you know, very diverse of discipline, gender, age, and experience that make the way we think together is rich and powerful. This on the last day we present the group work, and it's like a local politician, local government, they join us. And this is some crucial thing, maybe almost every day when we finish the workshop, we need to sit together and reflect what happened, what positive, what negative, or what the new idea emerged, or which story that touched them, what is the magic moment, whatever that people feel about the day we want to listen. That will guide us to the next day or to the next step. So whenever that we feel a worry or we don't know where to go, so we need to, you know, sit and discuss and listening. So the flow of co-creation in Yangon, we divide the group work since the beginning because we have a clear issue and focus to support the work of women group and Women for the World to produce a process where they can show the clear idea what the urban development and housing development for South Dagon, so they can apply to other township, how to set a township housing fund. In that way, they can have an idea how to deal with another city. So we divide into a four group work. The first group working with a lot of local community group on data and saving. And the second group dealing with urban planning and policy and fact finding about the land issue, the number of community, number of people, how they use land. And the third group is about housing design and planning. What should be the affordable housing? What it's good planning for the South Dagon city. And the last group we work with housing finance and mechanism in the township level. So this the last part that I try to look back to the co-creation process. What is the magic moment for me? Actually, it has so many. But when you are the foreigner and you able to go to the city that you never know before in your life, like the city of Jeneida, I never know that it exists before I met our friend, you know, who living there, who working there. So it bring me to the new unknown territory, and we always met a lot of good people. And on the ferry to Jeneida from Dhaka, you know, we met the shoe shining guy, and Meung want to support his business. And I listening to his story, and I really like the way he arranged the equipment. So I think this can be a magic moment for me when I met the people that sincere to their life, appreciate their life, appreciate their work, and they have so much to tell about how life is beauty, how the small thing that they did is meaningful for them. You know, it bring me out of the narrow mind, and to see he work very delicate, very, very mindful. It make me thinking about the work that I can do in the world, you know, no matter small or big, it doesn't matter. It's about how you dealing with your moment, sincerely respect and, you know, mindfulness and joy. You know, in every city, they will have a moment where you can rest your mind and eye in something new. This in the morning when we wake up and we go to the restaurant, we always saw the very beautiful light up of the bicycle of the worker. They are ready to work. It's very, very organized, very in order, but very lively. If you don't know the story, you may thinking of maybe some people just try to clear the water hyacinth, but actually they are the swimmer that will have a competition in the national level, or maybe in the future they will have a competition abroad, but they are national swimmer of Bangladesh. But they don't have a swimming pool in Jeneida. They use the river. And it, for me, it's just a very amazing, and it's have a lot of things to do, you know, to make the water is less pollution. It make me thinking a lot of things that why we need a swimming pool if we have a lot of good river and pond, but how about how we maintain it? How we take care of the nature, then we can have a good quality of swimmer, have a, you know, we can enjoy the water, we can enjoy the nature. So this give me a lot of good thought on the environment or the built environment that we have. And in our work, we always met a new people, always, that they love about their work. This guy, I forgot his name, but I like him a lot. He worked with the center in Jeneida. No? They manage the ecology treatment for the wastewater. It's very powerful and very simple ecological system, but it's work for the city. And he really have a deep knowledge about what he did, and he really loved what he worked. When he shared with us, it's always gentle, powerful, and very have a lot of good story to share, and very practical, you know. So you can learn a lot from this kind of people, not only the story, but the quality that he have in his work. He treat their staff very respectfully. And when you visit the organic market that organize every week in Jeneida, you will quite amazing of some, you know, some existing quality that already have there in the city, something that you cannot see as a foreigner if you don't know the people, you know. So this is very important to explore the reality and to keep asking the people in the city how they live, what the thing they love, because they will bring you to the important area that you will gain new confidence, new story. And this is the normal culture in many countries in Southeast Asia, I think, but this is in Myanmar. They will have a small shelter that they put the water, drinking water for other people. This in the informal settlement. No matter rich or poor, they always have this. And you can observe that in the informal settlement, they always have a lot of this. They still have. But in the urban area, I think they lost this kind of thing. But yeah, it's quite beautiful, you know, that the people sharing drinking water to each other. And each workshop, they have a lot of preparation, you know. One big workshop, it cannot succeed with only the coordinator or the leader, you know. We need a lot of preparation. We need a lot of people that care about that process. So before the workshop start, we have a lot of discussion. We need a lot of people that prepare for a little thing that will make a workshop smooth and, you know, is variety enough to open for all the people to share their idea. So it's like a preparation for the workshop in Jeneida. And we always have a lot of young people that interested about our work, or it have some calling to our work, and we share the story and we listen to them what they dream to do, what they want to do. You know, it's a good moment to embrace the new people. This in Pontianak, the young people, they enjoy the song with the last poet in Beting. And I enjoy a lot when we can share the deepest feeling about our work or some lesson learned, you know, the moment that we can reflect about our work. It keeps us grounding in what we have been doing and also learn a new thing. Many, many moments in the circle when we don't know where to go, when we don't know what to do, and when we very clear what to do, and when we really precise and powerful to think about something, you know, it's always give us a good moment. The moment we take action with people and the new actor show off, no matter kid or own people. When you organize the workshop in community or in the city, the new player will come because that's a calling. It's a real calling for them, you know, the action with intention will calling the people. And from a small work that you did today, you might not know it will lead to the whole city or the whole country movement, like in Myanmar. I never dream of Myanmar will go this far. Of course, I dream of it should go this far, but I never dreamed that it's possible in the time of, you know, controlling and violence. So thank to the people on the ground, thank to the living process that we trust. And the people can produce a lot of their own knowledge. And they can share that how to others freely. They never keep it for themselves, you know. It's not a competition, it's all about sharing. And again, you know, you might not know in the workshop, it will have emerging of new architect or new leader or new thinker. This girl came with her mom. And she just accompanied her mom. But when we ask about the dream house, she are the one who don't hesitate to draw. And she listening to all the mom dreaming about, oh, we need the house like this. This color, this white of the window and door, she are the one who draw, you know. And she also don't hesitate to make a model and teach others. So she's a real community architect at the age of 10. So how you can embrace and open the space for things to happen, this living system. And at the end, we can get clearer idea, what the dream, what the vision, how to move forward. And this can develop into a larger process for the whole country, for community network to show that dream in tangible and practical way. And, you know, the kid in Jenaida, when we work together for 5 days, we share about the dream, the existing thing in the community is powerful. We have the space for everyone in the workshop. Don't forget that, you know, we don't need to talk a lot as an architect. We should give the floor to the local people, to the kids, to the women, to the elderly, to the young people to share that dream. And the moment when we come up with solution and everyone be part of solution is the magic moment for me. From the eviction in Bagmati River that everyone is quite worried and like don't know where to go, don't know what to do. And we can build up the confidence from the groundwork, from the information, from the solution from other country, from the global solution. So we can come up with some idea that grounded and possible, you know, that we can advocate, that we can live in for, that we can contribute for. And we see the role of each of us to contribute to the dream, you know. We don't need to wait for policy to change. And in our work, when we open to the government, they are not our enemy anymore, but they are partners. So we always find a good governor, like in Saudagong, the politician, the parliament member. He share a dream. He shared his vision and actually the same vision that we want to go. So we develop a friendship, not in the hierarchy, but in the same ground, same floor, that we can talk as a friend. This in Venezuela, the same. We met a mayor, we have been working together, we show them the solution, we show them how hard we work together within 5 days, and with the respect, we can have a dialogue, not a negotiation about what we need, but the dialogue about what we dream together. And in Jeneida, it gives us a new powerful way, you know, to experiment or advocate about your dream physically. So we make a real space arrangement in the real side that how it be like, you know, our dream. It's very powerful and people can have experience about it. And housing keep growing. It's not finished when you finish the drawing, finish the model, finish the first house model, whatever. It keep growing because people is there. So you need to keep in mind that this kind of work is always growing and changing, incremental. But what is the direction and who are the one who maintain this flow of energy? Yeah, I think 3 states of work, grounding, holding, and relax. We should balance it, you know, in every state. If we feel it too intense to work or to walk in the unknown, we need to stop, have a break, and bring ourselves back to what we know, you know. So it's important to balance our work life. And always the magic moment when we find the answer, but we cannot speak it out. And we feel, you know, close to each other. We feel without anyone, without anything, without any single thing, this kind of solution cannot emerge. I think this kind of moment is a magic moment for me. When we get it, that we need everyone and be part of everything and trust the deepest knowledge that we have. But we need to go to that state, you know, always in the moment and with the respect of yourself and people. And this the I think the last presentation is very long. For this period of time, it's reminding us, you know, we worry a lot about the COVID and epidemic, the health issue. But actually, you know, the word hell, whole, and holy came from the same root word, from Latin word, no, I think. So that give us a clue, you know, to have a good health of individual, you need to reconnect with the society, with, of course, your body, with your society, with community, family, with the city, with environment. You need to become whole in terms of the process you think, the process you act, the process you live, the process you work. In that way, you know, when you return to the whole, it's a holy. No matter what you do, I think this gives us the real essence of what is the co-creation should be for the future. And I will finish it with the poetry again. I open it with how the nature work in co-creative way. You know, we keep explore it, we keep manifest it, we keep experience it, and this. Poetry from Rachel Naomi Remen. She's a doctor and she's a good writer and spiritual practitioner. She changed the way the medical university study about disease and thing in the US and the in the world. You know, she bring back the sense of human as a doctor, as a medication professional. We need to concern the spiritual part. And this is her poetry. Everything has a deep dream. I spent many years learning how to fix life, only to discover at the end of the day that life is not broken. There is a hidden seed of greater wholeness in everyone and everything. We serve life best when we water it and reframe it. When we listen before we act, in befriending life, we do not make things happen according to our own design. We uncover something that is already happened in us and around us, and create conditions that enable it. Everything is moving toward its place upon us, always striking against us. Everything has a deep dream of itself and its fulfillment.